bring my PowerPoint.
Should work.
Basically, I had to create a deck for this. I think it's got like 2 slides. Basically, what we try to encourage here with developing for Espresso is we know the thing that we started on this Espresso journey about 2 years ago, and we sort of did quite a bit of research in finding out what a mobile application has to do. So obviously you need this entire this management platform that will handle over your own device thing, right? So that piece we sort of went from on the server side, where we can allow you to create menus, update menus, change menus, give users access to the mobile platform, keep the users access to maintaining and developing applications, etc. So that piece we worked out. The piece that really stumbled us, because as developers we want to be able to write one piece of code and target any single platform or device. And we sort of went with the HTML5 way of doing things. But as you know, if you develop a mobile application using HTML5, you lose sort of access to the native capabilities of the device. So you lose access to the camera, and you lose access to the GPS locator, and you lose access to pretty much anything native to the device. So we have to make a plan around that. So we built an infrastructure around our application that will allow us to access the device's native capabilities. We know we needed to sort out offline. Right? So as a developer of an application, or a third-party mobile application, well, you're looking to sort out any device, any platform, or one piece of source code. You want to be able to do offline capability. And as a developer, you know that how that's going to be, being able to cache the information and build a sync manager. And the whole infrastructure, the whole architecture behind that is not just, oh yeah, if then else sort of statements. Customization. Any of you built an Objective-C application or something in Android? How many of you built in customization? No? You just, too much like hardware, right? Charting. A charting engine which not only takes a snapshot, like previously we've seen on mobile devices, they literally take a snapshot, a picture of the image on the server, and they stream the bitmap across to the client. And it's of no use to you, because there's no tab switches, there's no drawdown, there's no tooltips. Push notifications. So that was quite a clever interjection. Where you can't just send a push notification to your device. I can't just do that. I have to send it to the OEM. So I have to send it to Microsoft, I have to send it to Apple, and I have to send it to Android. And basically, we have to build 3 services around it. Native capabilities, have access to the camera without writing any code, have access to the signature pad or the scanning device. So those are all of the, I call it the tenants. Right? And if you guys had to say, I would like to write a customer query and it will support all of this, yeah, good luck, right? So what we've done at SYSPRO is we want to encourage our community to start building applications. We wanted to make it so much easier. So what we said is we'll build you a platform. We'll build you a plugin that sits inside of Visual Studio. And all you have to do is worry about writing the code. So if a customer wants a customer query application that shows the header information, you should be able to do that in your normal way. And we will sort out the rest for you. We will sort out any, we will make sure that it works on any device, any platform, that automatically out the box, if you follow our rules, you'll get offline capability. You'll get access to the sync manager. You'll have customization by operator, by device, by application. You'll have native capabilities, all the native capabilities that we support. You'll have automatically in your application. Push notifications, you'll get that straight out of the box. VI and charting, write to our rules, follow our steps, you'll get that out. That's my second slide. In order to start developing Espresso applications on your local development machine, you obviously need SYSPRO Espresso running. SYSPRO Espresso is a web application that runs in IIS. We built it in a way that it supports 64-bit, so no longer do we have to cripple IIS into a 32-bit environment, so it runs native 64-bit. We use our data, the way we get the data from SYSPRO is via our WCF .NET service, right? So that's the 2 prerequisites that you need. You need Visual Studio 2012. We haven't tested it on the student version yet. I don't think it will be an issue. Visual Studio student edition?
Same.
It's the same, right?
Or cheaper, or free.
Or free, yeah. basically, there's a plugin that you install on top of Visual Studio, which gives you all this functionality. Obviously, skills required, but a C#, depending. Obviously, the easy things are easy to do, like in VB scripting. If you want to simply take a form, put it together, I guarantee it's one line of code. But when you start to do grids or when you're doing sales order entry, where you have to check the setup option or check the type of stop code and switch the quantity of units and pieces, you're going to have to know a little bit of JavaScript because you want to make your application slick, hide fields, show fields. So you'll need a little bit of JavaScript in there. And then obviously you have to be comfortable with the notion of ASP.NET MVC. Anybody work with that yet? Yeah? So you understand model view controller. If you ever worked with that, you worked with MVVM? Yeah, MVVM is pretty much follows the same structure of MVC, just happens on the client. So we use a combination of MVC and MVVM to do the binding.
Sorry.
Okay. So what we're going to attempt to do here is build an application. We're going to build an application using Visual Studio. We're going to deploy it to SYSPRO Espresso. We're going to show you how you can debug it. And you'll see that we pretty much hook up everything for you. So we'll attach to the debugger so you can debug through your code. We'll generate the code for you. But what I just wanted to show you very quickly was the directory structure. So Espresso will be installed to INET pub, obviously, dub-dub-root, SYSPRO Espresso. And what happens is, in the bin folder, you will see there's a whole syspro.saw and syspro.what. And these will be all the standard applications that we will release out of the box. And each of these applications, each of these DRLs, they have various different components in them. So if I look at the ARS, right, they would have the customer header. They would have customer invoices. They would have anything to do with the customer invoicing chart. They would have all of these pre-built into them. And same goes for cash book and inventory and purchase orders and what. So anything that starts with SYSPRO is our ones. Don't start your components when you build them with SYSPRO. Because if we come up with the same name as you, guess what? We're just going to override yours. Good practice would be your company name. Yeah? When you're building an application, there's two ways you can do it. There's one, you can just deploy it straight into this area, but there's also another way where you can put it in a debug mode. So you as a developer, you're developing on a live system because you maybe want to use the live data, but you don't want anybody to have access to this application. So what you can do is you can put it in a debug mode. So you can actually test in a live environment without affecting the rest of the company. Right, so let's go and write some code. That's the end of my PowerPoint. Step what time do I have to finish it?
1 o'clock.
Full sum of my time now.
You're stealing from life.
Yes, stealing from life. So from a support point of view, how do you know what version of the editor you have installed? Basically, going to the extensions and update manager. There's a SYSPRO Espresso development plugin, and basically there's the version there. So check up on these versions. We try to do NuGet packages on that, but we always say to register with Microsoft, and it's struggling a bit with that. So that this plugin will automatically update itself when we have a new version. So we try to work with the NuGet team to try to pull it down, but we thought we'd finish the editing first. How do you get it installed? I'm simply going to uninstall mine very quickly. Close that, close Visual Studio. I'm going to show you how to install it from our latest build area. So basically, you guys will be provided with something called a SYSPRO Espresso Development Plugin, a VSIX. You double click on it when you get it. It will be available on the DVD, on the SYSPRO 7 DVD, and later updates will obviously be available off the support. So it will sit there for a few seconds while it initializes. You click on that, read the terms and conditions, click the install button, and your plugin should be installed. It installs, it's pretty simple. Go into Visual Studio, and the first thing we want to do is develop a new project. Right? What should we develop? If we do a customer query, I think, and then show you how we can take all the other components that has already been previously developed, and then try integrate it into the customer application. So what we try to do, our goal here is to build a customer query screen for a customer query screen or application. Right, so first thing you do, typical Visual Studio style, you will file your project, and the first thing you will see is that we have a new template in there called SYSPRO Espresso. And as a C sharp, we only support C sharp, so sorry for the VB guys. I'm going to click on the obviously select the location, and I'm going to call it sample customer app. Right, I simply click on the OK button, and make sure I'm running on the framework 4.5. And once I click the OK button, watch the bottom left hand corner, because what we will do is we will start adding all of the DLLs, all the OData feeds, all the OData, all the JSON DLLs that's required to run this program. Okay, so when I click on the OK button, it's going to sit there for a few seconds, and you'll see it adds all the Razor stuff, the web APIs that we need. And then we have a project. And in our project, what you'll see, we automatically created a controller, a model, and a view. Because that's what MVC stands for. Model, view, controller. Okay. What a model is typically a class that represents what you want to show on the screen. But the class is the actual background piece. So if I'm building a customer object, right, a customer query object, what's the first thing I need? Customer code. I might need a customer name. I might need the branch, the address details, the salesperson, the branch. So all of the properties of that particular customer, right, is going to be my model. Does that make sense to everyone? Typical class, C-sharp class. Right. We also have a readme.txt in here that shows you in pretty much 6 steps you'll be able to build an application from start to scratch. I'm sorry, from start to end. The first thing we're going to do is create a model. Okay, so I'm going to right click on the models folder, add a new item, and again we've injected into Visual Studio some templates so that you don't have to write any code. So I said we're going to create a model. I'm going to select the model, and I'm going to call this model customer header. Click on the add button. As soon as you click on the add button, we get all of this event programmatically, and we tell Visual Studio, you know what? I need to show one of our forms. Click on the add button, and you'll see this is something new. It's not a Visual Studio form, it's something we've created. Okay. This then asks you a few questions, and it has a few tooltips to tell you what the tooltips are for, what the prompts are for. It says, Mr. Developer, what would you like to create? Would you like to create a display form? And I'll show you what a display form is. By the way, you don't have to have the mobile devices. You can actually use a browser, and you can test it on there.
It's better to use Chrome, though, isn't it?
It is better to use Chrome, but I've just been testing with the Internet Explorer 10, and it seems to be working.
Amazing.
Yeah. So if I look at, let's say I look at a supplier's application, and I select a particular supplier. This is called a search, by the way, and if you went to the custom search, also build a custom search with the Espresso. So this is a display form. You can see this customer information pane. That's typically what you would call a display form, and that's what we're trying to build. That's a grid, obviously. And then obviously you guys have seen the charts. And when you saw the sales order entry application, that was an entry application. So the system's asking you, what type of component would you like to build? Would you like a display form, an entry form, a chart, or a grid? And if you choose a chart, you'll see it now ask you for some chart options. It says, tell me the class, tell me your x-axis, tell me your y-axis. If you have a grid, it also has some grid options. It says, oh, if you have a grid, would you like a filter, for example, including invoices? And we actually build the entire user interface, which tells the type of filters that you require. For now, we're going to do a display form. And an easy bit here would be, instead of going to create the class from scratch, so create a customer class, add in a customer property or a name property. We decided we'll build some code up for you. So we're building a customer query application. I'm going to say build one from an XSD. I'm going to navigate to my base schemas folder. And I know the business object that returns back customer information is called ARSQRY. ARSQRY. So we're going to take the XSD out. Click on the open button. This program will then interrogate the schema. It will then find all of the nodes inside the schema, and now we can see there's a header component there which gives us the company name, the address information, solvency address information, currencies, all of that stuff. This also shows us that we have some customer notes, and that's children of this customer header, so I can choose to include the children to my model or not. So what I'm simply going to do is select the header and say create. System will sit in the background, and guess what? Generated all of their code for you.
That's cool.
Checks in the mail though. Yeah, okay. So I have probably close on about 70 properties here. And you as a developer, the worst thing that you like doing is passing XML. Right? You know, business object gets called, get some XML. Now guess what? We've got to take that XML, load it up into an XML document, or link to XML and start parsing through it. And then you have to actually, if you write good code, you have to check if the node exists. And if it doesn't exist, give it a blank string and all of that stuff. So having to do that for 70 properties, yeah, that's not really good. So what we've done is we've done the parsing for you as well. And when we parse the XML, we have applied to the various different properties. And you can see we're checking if the node exists. And if it does exist, all you then do is set that property. So far, we haven't written any bit of code yet. The next thing we need to do is we need to create a controller. Now we've sort of went a little bit off the track, because what we wanted to do is we wanted to split out the user interface from the actual data. Right. So think about your mobile application. The very first time you deploy it, it needs to get onto someone's device. So on our device, we've got some clever code that says, has this app ever been run on this device? If it hasn't been run, go to the server and go and fetch me the user interface. Right? And then when they actually select the data, then we say go to the server, get me the data. So the next time you use this application, you say, ah, you've run this application before. I don't have to fetch the user interface. I just have to fetch data. Right? And then we just take the data from the server and bind it to the user interface on the client. That way, we're not sending so much HTML. Because you can imagine the HTML text going back and forth. So what we do is we only send back data unless the user interface has changed. And that way, we can make the application as light and as efficient as possible. So the first controller that we're going to create is going to be a normal controller. And this controller literally brings back the user interface that we've been creating. So I'm going to right-click. It sounds complex. You don't have to write any code. You right-click, you say add, new item. And I said controller, so we're going to select the controller. We'll call the sample customer info. The controller, when you guys start building applications, obviously every single Espresso application will have to be published on the App Store. Something quite important, like the name of your DLL, because imagine you have a customer and he's purchased an app from the App Store, another app from another supplier and another app. So those DLLs, we don't want them to override each other. So if you call yours My Customer Application or My Customer Component, and you build an application called My Customer Application, whichever one goes that last is going to win. So we always suggest that you put something unique. So you guys at BNR will probably call yours BNR Customer Application. You guys might call it Tony Carroll Customer Application, something like that. You guys need to be unique, right? In the App Store, when you register to build an Espresso application, give it a name. And when you put your name in there, we will be building functionality into the App Store to make sure that nobody else has that name. So that's one of the other reasons why you want to be doing it, why we're forcing you to go through the App Store. Okay. So we're building up, adding a controller. And again, code generated for you. You don't have to do anything. The next thing we need to do is actually, so this is for the user interface. Now we're going to build a web controller, and the web controller is going to get the data from SYSPRO, bind it to the user interface, or bind it to the model, and then lastly we create a view. So again, we're going to right click on there, just copy the name of this. I like to keep this as a standard, so you can see what it's calling automatically. But it's called automatically sample customer info, and we've automatically added the word controller to the end of it. So I'll right click on there, and I'll say I would like to add a new web controller. I'll give it the same name as my controller, and what the system will do in the background is it will append web controller to it. And now we've got a web controller. In this web controller, when somebody selects a new customer, we need to call a business object to get the data and bind it to our class. So if you go to view, and you go to other windows, SYSPRO Espresso, you will see we have a new window called SYSPRO Espresso. And what this window is actually context sensitive to the application or piece of code that you're in. It's now figured out that you are in a web controller, and it now wants to help you to create a method. So it says, Mr. Developer, what's this controller for? Is it for a display form? Please tell me the data model you'd like to populate from this method. And because you've already created a customer sample header model in this class, it found it. Select that. Give it a method name. Get customer header. And now you can say, what's the key field? And that's going to be customer. Yeah. So if you're going to insert method, and what it's done is it's generated the code for you as well. Because this is, and you can see there's quite a bit of, there's more comments in here than code. Right? I'm like a developer, right?
Comments are what you use to remove the code that you don't want to use, right?
So guys, what we've done here is, as you know, in 4.5 there's this await and async method which allows you to do stuff a lot more slicker. We actually do support that. By default, we use a normal method, but if you want, just comment out that line there and comment in the async method, and then you can actually use the await keyword. Our WCF infrastructure supports async and await. We suggest you use that, because it gives you a better user interface, look and feel. It doesn't look like the applications hanging, right, querying a lot of information. All of our applications that we build, out of the box, we're using async and support. Sorry, await and async. Okay. So here we have our customer sample header model. A new instance of it has been created. And the only thing left for us to do is build up the XML for the business object. So again, we're not going to write any code. I'm just going to use e.net diagnostics. I'm going to go to the ARSQRY business object. I'm going to say load the sample XML. So I'm going to clean up this XML a little bit. We'll take on some of these options, but it's a demo, obviously. We'll replace that with the placeholder. Simply go to edit utilities and say generate me some C# code. That's now built up a string builder for me. Copy that. I will paste that in there. And lastly, you will notice the signature here, guys. It's because you told me when we created this method that the key field to this method is customer. I've already built up the signature for you. Right. So I'm just going to do a append format on that. And on there, I'm going to say customer. And that's the same customer code that came in there. I'm just saying String.format, take whatever the user selected from the search and replace it in there. Yeah. This is the only line of code I'm going to write. I'm going to go string XML out is equal to. Now you guys know that when you want to speak to WCF or to the login infrastructure or e.net, the first thing you got to do, get the operator code, get the user, the company code, the password. Call a logon method, get back the session ID from the session ID, call the query method. So we've said you don't have to do that anymore because the user's already logged into Espresso. In the background, we've got the username, we've got the password, we've got all of that information in there. So what we give to you is something called the underscore SYSPRO communication object. So all you have to do now is call underscore SYSPRO communication dot query. And if you were going to use the query, sorry, the task, the async methods, then you would call it query async. So I'm going to do a query. This session ID that we're passing to you is not the GUID. Right? It's something we use to maintain state. Okay. But inside there somewhere encrypted is the GUID. And that's how we know it. Good luck trying to find it. So I'm going to pass in session ID. I'm going to pass in the name of the business object, which in this case is the ARSQRY. And I am going to pass in the XML in document.toString. Right, this model that we've created, if I actually go to the model, right here, come on, I'm going to see if I think my virus checker is kicking in. not because I wrote bad code, because I think they scheduled it at this time of the morning. Go to definition. There's the model, right? And all that this model is expecting, the constructor to this model is expecting the XML in, which is in theory, well, not in theory, in practical, the XML out from the business. I'm going to go back there. Into this model, I'm going to pass in XML out. Make sense?
Mm-hmm.
I've called, built up the XML in. I've called the business object, taking out the XML, and I'm sending it into this class, which will then pass all of the XML, put it into various different properties. Build that. We built our model, built our controllers. The last thing we need to do is build the view. The view is the thing that the user will actually see. Come to my Solution Explorer. Add a new item. Again, this time we're going to do a display form view. Customer sample. Add button. Again, another dialog this pops up. Again, to help us generate code for you. It says, tell me the data model. Because it's in the project, we know about it. Tell me the key field. It's customer. You created a web API. Tell me where's that web API. Customer sample web info. That's it there. It says, inside that class, what method would you like to get this customer information? Get customer edit. That's the method you know, right? The group name, GRP customer header. Group description.
Just explain what the group header is.
We'll do that. Basically, the group name is the ID of the div in the HTML. So if you wanted to hide and show that div, you'd refer to it from that. And group description is the actual description that the user will see. And group description is the piece that will get translated. It's another thing we sort out for you automatically. Is that if the user logs in as Chinese or French into Espresso, the entire user interface will be automatically converted to Chinese and French. So that's why when you build your apps, you can publish it on the global app store. And guess what? Anyone using it around the world will automatically inherit these localization of their app. Okay. Click on the create button. Basically, there's Visual Studio warning you, saying we're going to generate some HTML with some JavaScript in there. Do you trust Kevin's code? If you don't, well, you have to write it yourself. If you do, we'll generate all of this code for you. Right, and this is typical MVC, and we're looking into the Razor classes here, so if you're comfortable with Razor, this is just pretty much Razor. You'll see we have Espresso display item pair fours. Right, and you'll find that we have this Espresso this and Espresso that, Espresso entry form field. What that does is it says go to the model, go and fetch the property company M and display it as this Espresso thing. Now why we suggest you always use this, because you could just go to the model and say M.company in your view. We always suggest you use the Espresso display item pair form. And the reason for that is because in the background, we will then handle, if you're coming from an Android, we'll send back to the Android stuff. If you're coming from an iPhone, then we'll send back the user interface from an iPhone. And if you've got a camera object, then we'll handle the images for a camera. And we'll handle the translation. So this piece of code is sort of the meat of handling all of that clever stuff. This was the GRP customer header. So we grouped that internally. That's the customer header. If there were any errors, we actually create an area for you to handle your errors. We do that for you automatically. We call all of the APIs again. Been very good. Unlike any developer, the comments in here will help you build and extend some of your code. We've got one last step. I'm going to go to my Solution Explorer. We go into our, just save that, go into our customer info controller. This is for Espresso component, and you can see what it's saying is that we're missing a method. Okay, so automatically detected that in our controller we're missing a method, so I just select that method, click insert. Again, this is the bit that's generating our user interface for us. We know the language code, so we're going to now build the user interface in a different language and send that out to it. If I build that, I should build it with my errors. Yay! And what I'm going to do now is on the tool menu, I'm going to say debug Espresso project. it's turned to orange, that bar, which means it's in debug mode. I can now go to a browser. You can see in the background it's trying to load up all of the symbols. It's trying to attach to the debugger as well. So the very first time it takes quite a long time because it types the thing that DLL loaded up into the debugger, does the pre-jitting and you know all that stuff. Just gonna stop that for a second. There. We're going to go into something called the application builder now. Because all we've done now, guys, is we've built a component. What we need to do is take that component and put it into an application. Okay, so we go to the application builder. And we're going to create a new application. And it's going to be called the customer. It's going to be a display application. The primary key field is going to be customer. I'm going to go to manage components and I'm going to search for customer sample. And you'll notice what you found, customer sample, and you'll also notice that it's in debug mode.
Can it found that component in a specific folder?
It's in a specific folder. So when you do tools debug in inetpub, the root, for Espresso, there's a debug folder there, and we've got this Espresso debug component. In this file, we have all of the relevant information, so we know about it, we know the component type, we know the description, we know where the DLL is as well. Okay, so we're not actually copying the DLL in there, we're telling the infrastructure, go to this DLL where Mr. Developer is developing from, so we're always finding this latest DLL, we know DLL now, etc. Back in there, I'm going to select that component. I'm going to choose for it to be in line. Go back to the details and say, yes, please, I'd like to add this to the menu as well. Click on the save button. And on my menu, hopefully, there's demo customer here. When I tap on demo customer, it's hooked up the search for me. So I've got a complete search for my customer application. I can then select the customer. It'll take a few seconds. And there we go. Customer header application. Start to end with one line of code. So what you can do... Thank you, Phil. So what we can do now is if you wanted to group that into different areas, like say we wanted to take this customer header information and call it customer info. And then we wanted to take... let's just copy that. But let's say from there on in, close that. I'm going to have another one and call that customer additional. Yep. With that additional information. So now I've got two groups, I've got two categories. Right? And I've grouped them separately. Yep. Save that. Hold. Again, all I have to do each time I change another code. I have to say debug, put it in debug mode. I can go back into Espresso. And basically the debug literally copies all the bits and pieces and tells the Espresso infrastructure about this new area, about this new change that you've done to the code. And again, because you changed the DLL, it's going to compile it and jet it and all of that good stuff. Click on usernames, demo customer, sit there for a few seconds. Select that particular customer. And you'll see now I've got customer information there. And then additional information. And you know what? All of the customization features that I showed you yesterday, click on design, it's all built into your code for you. And let's say you had to build this for a particular customer, and the customer says, you know what? I also need to see invoices. And I also want an image, and I want access to the camera object. So because we've built all of those components and our custom form fields, I go to manage components, I add a new component, let's look for image.
Talking about specific features.
out. I want to go to application folder. Was it customer demo? Application name.
Demo. This is all around.
There we go. Components. That. Say customer. There we go. I can say I would like to add the custom form fields objects for customers. I'm going to make that a link. I would like to add images. So add the image object. I want the image object to be the first thing that the user sees. And I like that to be inline. And lastly, maybe I'd like to add invoices. Customer invoices. That must be a link. And age analysis. Age. See what else I have here. Invoices are there, paging invoices are now a pop-up in your application, and there's your invoices. Also. So taking a little bit of code, actually one line of code, a few steps, you're able to build stuff a lot quicker. Important thing to note, guys, is you know, when we build the stuff at SYSPRO Corporate, basically we build the customer components, you'll be able to use that free inside your applications.
Right.
So you wouldn't need, if you built a CRM, third-party CRM system inside Espresso and you created CRM's information, and then you needed to get the customer header component or customer invoices, you'd be able to simply drag that into your application and you won't have to license the business objects for the components we developed.
So you just do that through the way you just showed there, not through the network.
Yep.
How was it you exported what you just did out again so you could apply that to multiple users? Yeah, that question is so about.
Yes, so inside, so the question is, how do I built this now, yeah. And so obviously saved for myself, so in the database it's saved for Kevin. How do I take that and deploy that to a role? So inside SYSPRO, we don't have the tools yet, I think I have one or two of them. Inside SYSPRO, we have an entire management studio, where you can say, I would like to take Kevin's demo for customer, and I'd like it to copy it for role ABC. So there's a whole set of programs that we're busy working on. So there's the Espresso devices, hopefully it's going to work. We can control all of the devices. There's Espresso component types, it shows you all the different component types, charts, toolbars, screens. Espresso layouts, its application, I'm not sure if it's not working yet. So it shows you all of the layouts, and basically you're able to change that or copy that to another user, another operator, another company.
You can do it at a role level.
And you can do that at a role level as well. So this is pretty much going to be
demo customer down the bottom.
Yeah. Oh, okay, there we go. There's our demo customer. Was it there? There we go. So they're not all spoken words. In here, you're going to build in a copy button that will allow you to copy to another area or role or company. The user interface, we're just playing with it. Paul's going to be helping us to do some clever stuff so that when we copy menus, we'll actually see the tiles in SYSPRO. Take this style from this user's menu and copy to another user's menu. So we'll try and make it as visual as possible, just because it's just so much information to show. Questions?
Yes. Could you talk a little bit more about the application? So if you're actually downloading data, are you just downloading the data to the view, or
only downloading the data? request.
Okay, so if somebody adds additional columns in the view, does that mean, does that invalidate the cache, or is, do you have to download it again, or?
Oh, no, even though your stuff's hidden, you mean when you put in some customization?
No, yes, sorry, yeah.
Yeah, when you've done some customization, just keep that on this, sorry. So you're asking that, even though, even if the user has done that, that,
yeah,
and that, in the background, the user is still there, we still pull that data down.
Okay.
Because the user can obviously just go back in here and choose to add that field back, and then you don't want to do another call back to the server to get the information.
If that's, that's cached, say 2 months later, you rewrite the app and you add some extra columns or fields.
As soon as you add new columns to the model,
yeah,
then the new interface is pulled down from your controller.
But that means, does that mean the cache data is lost because it can't match up?
No, no, because there won't be any cache data for it, so it'll be blank.
Oh, because it's a new...
It's new columns. Yeah.
So, so as soon as you go online, the cache is actually emptied anyway? Or?
No, the cache is never emptied, the cache is just updated. So if the system detects that you're online, that you have an internet connection, it will never ever use the cache data. It will always go to live data.
There was an option to clear the cache.
Yes. Correct. There is an option. Oops, if you go home, account details. This is where you can in the app put the administrator details, so if the user actually has problems, you can put the name, the email address, the number, and there you can actually say clear offline data and go actually clear the cache for
you. Is it when caches, is it cache requests or is it caching the actual
it's
records?
It's caching the actual, because we send JSON from the client to the service.
It's caching the JSON. Yeah, that's what, yeah, okay.
Because then we just take the JSON and we bind it.
Is that why you had the option to mark something as hidden? You had inline, tabbed, but also hidden, so you could capture that extra data?
No,
so
hidden bits is, we needed to have some hidden stuff so that makes the user interface a lot more cleaner. I'll give you an example. If I take you to sales analysis. Come on, wake up. So in sales analysis, you see I have this period's gross profit, this month's gross profit. But when I tap on this one, I'm executing some JavaScript, right, to show me another view, right? And when I tap on that, I want to show another view, correct? So I'm drilling down. When I go back, you can see all this information. All the views just get stacked and show again. This application itself, you'd think it might just contain one component called company sales totals, but in actual fact, it contains a gazillion, and they're all just hidden. And that way we can say, when you tap on something, go to this view. And this view, or this component is actually embedded in this application.
But you do that programmatically in the C-sharp code?
In the C-sharp, in the JavaScript code.
The JavaScript.
Tap. So that's why we created Inform. We do the same thing in sales order entry. We have some components. So it's components that you require, but it doesn't necessarily have to be on the screen.
Push an app up to the app store, effectively you're pushing the components and you may have an application that you frame that with. That means that anybody who buys that can also use your components and customize them the same way.
Correct.
Yeah.
That's the power of it.
Yeah, that's pretty
possible.
Yeah.
So that's a very good point I forgot to make as well. Is you was the developer, you developed this pretty little demo customer application. Now you think, I can make money off this and put it up in the app store. You would have to go into SYSPRO, right? We will have an applications component, and there will be an export button. So you'll be able to take that application and say export it, or prep for application app store, for app store. And basically we will go, pick up all the DLLs, all of the metadata required for this application, because you don't just want to send out the components, you've got to send out the pre-built application. So we package up everything, create a zip file for you. You will take that zip file and upload it to the app store. When the customer purchases it, you will download this little zip file, we'll go into the applications in the App Store and say, I would like to add this new application, and we'll take that information and put it into the Espresso database. So it's an export-import job.
So that's why we did the whole thing, because we wanted to control, to make it easier for developers to crunch the internet, to worry about where stuff is.
You don't have to create the SIs, you don't have to create all of that stuff. And the nice thing is, if you have a new version, just pop it up on the App Store. The customer will get notified, hey, there's a new version you need to download.
In terms of IP, like you see often with the Apple Store, an app will come out from a third-party developer, and then the next iOS version that's an integrated. Do you guys review the developments that you put up by third party and say that's really good, we might just throw that in as a part of our release? How are you protecting developers in terms of if they're innovative in putting ideas forward?
You mean you might look and say that's a good idea?
Free, yeah.
I don't know, I suppose that happens in the last 30 years, I suppose.
Obviously, but do you liaise with developers and say, hey, can we work together, like, be like, we did this, or...
We might, but it hasn't happened yet. Yeah. Actually, the App Store is still, in the scheme of things, quite recent.
Yeah.
So who knows, 5 years from now, quite a different conversation.
Although you can develop applications and put it up in choice specific, that's the point. We're not suggesting you do that. We're suggesting build applications that build up the community, because the more applications that you have, if you put it up on the App Store, people are going to buy it, you're obviously going to get revenue for that. But the whole community starts to learn. The whole community starts to play.
It's true to say, if you take something like VNR, they're more likely to write stuff for VNR, and they don't have to share the IP. They have some differential to the company.
But they might do something clever like the workflow stuff.
Well, they might not. And what am I pointing
to?
I suspect that we will do something clever.
No, it's really my point.
Yeah.
Right. I mean, you can't do, as I made a point that yesterday, you can't do it yet, you will be allowed to say. So VNR do something. Your only way, I know it sounds odd, yeah. You guys write something for yourself and you won't be allowed to use it.
Yeah.
You have to put it on the App Store. It's just the way we have to do it. But you can say you're the only person who can use it. And you protect your IP that way if you want to do that. You can also, by the way, in the App Store, supposing, this is an odd one that's happened from time to time. Supposing here in Australia, you've written something for somebody, like another partner, and you have a deal with a partner, and now you decide to bypass the partner, because and you want to make something available, but the partner says to you, hang on, I thought you and I had an OEM agreement. Oh yeah, I'll tell you what, I'll go on the App Store and say you can't buy it in Asia Pacific, but you can buy it in the rest of the world. So you can do stuff like that. So there's quite a lot of work we've learned over the last year about how to help people protect their IP.
And that app will support push notifications, any device, pretty much all of those things that I mentioned earlier, anything that I've demoed, just sort it out. Provided you build it on site, using all the money. And that's it,
no.
Pretty much.
Very
take
good.
Any questions.
How do I do that?
How do I do that?